operating a weapon. It's no different than someone putting a 45 caliber in your hand and you pointing it recklessly at someone.
Names like Ray Rice.
My actions that night were totally inexcusable.
Rob Ford.
Yes, I have smoked crack cocaine.
Donald Sterling.
It's a terrible mistake, and I'll never do it again.
Now synonymous with scandal. And even though the media spotlight won't last, the damage can last forever on the web.
In this day and age, we are who Google says we are.
Ask any parent and they'll say having kids is the best thing that ever happened to them. But it can also make your head spin.
Canine's tied to a tree on a heavy chain. There's obvious signs of scarring on its face.
The game's called Necnominate. It involves filming yourself downing an often alcoholic drink cocktail, then posting it online and nominating friends to outdo you.
Palm trees glistening under the sun, toes planted in the sand, and the warm Gulf waters.
I'm Patrick Nolan on the western edge of the seawall with the story of people who are in the communities that don't have a seawall to protect them down there. I'll have their story.
For years, TV guys like myself have covered severe weather from the center of the action.
I'm standing at what used to be the waterline, but as you can see, the ocean swelled in a hurry, the flooding continuing all the way toward the middle part of the island.
Long after the TV cameras left the small town of Ferguson, Missouri, these are the images still fresh in the minds of Americans. Tense riots, flash grenades, police covered in riot gear from head to toe. Shotguns and rifles in hand, armored vehicles patrolling the streets as anger bubbled over. And military-grade equipment in the hands of police officers.
This is a war situation. When was the last time you looked around and saw that this was Baghdad? This is not. We don't need those here on our streets.
Dr. Pamela C. is an attorney and a legal studies professor at Florida Gulf Coast University.
What I see is a concern over the intimidation that the people feel.
Dr. C. and activists across the country are outraged that weaponry like this seen in Ferguson is in the hands of local law enforcement agencies in all 50 states. Thanks to a government program.
But they belong in a military situation. They do not belong on the streets of Southwest Florida.
The 1033 program, or the Department of Defense Excess Property Program, has been turning over guns and gear no longer in use by the U.S. military since the 1990s to more than 17,000 local police forces. Fournier Corner requested information from the Department of Defense on what military equipment your local law enforcement agencies have stockpiled. Here's what we found. The Fort Myers Police Department has received several items, from 36 M16 assault rifles to armored cars and a mine-resistant ambush patrol vehicle, or the MRAP, seen here responding to a standoff in the city this summer. The Charlotte County Sheriff's Office has also requested an MRAP along with 7 helicopters over the years, several of which have been used for parts to keep their 3 working choppers in the air. The Charlotte County Sheriff's Office also has an explosive robot and 144 M16 rifles. Punta Gorda PD's grabbed just more than a dozen M16 rifles from the DOD. Cape Coral PD, following suit, has added 58 M16 rifles to their arsenal from the program. And the Lee County Sheriff's Office has 60 assault rifles. But the Collier County Sheriff's Office has the longest-running relationship with the program, receiving 3 helicopters to upkeep their 2 operational choppers, 80 infrared units, a bomb robot, more than 371 M16 assault rifles, and countless emergency operation supplies, all of which Operations Chief Jim Bloom of CCSO says is critical for the department to stay afloat.
Either we wouldn't be able to provide a service, or costly, would have to raise taxes in order to supply that kind of equipment.
So that's the bottom line here. Without that program, the Collier County Sheriff's Department would not be able to police as efficiently.
That is true, in my opinion.
But law enforcement agencies that have grown dependent on the program could be on the course for a rude awakening. In the aftermath of Ferguson, President Barack Obama has charged the Department of Defense with looking into how local law enforcement agencies get access to military-grade equipment. Meanwhile, lawmakers in the House have introduced a bill that would gut the 1033 program, something Dr. C says needs to happen now.
That doesn't go far enough. I think they ought to stop the programs. If your only tool is a hammer, everything you see is going to be a nail.
While the Collier County Sheriff's nails down how it would effectively police without help from the feds,
Collier County would take a tremendous hit from the loss of our two helicopters.
KPD is looking to opt out of the program, returning their several dozen M16-style rifles back to cinder. Here's why.
The tactical response vehicle that we had was a Vietnam-era vehicle. Come to find out, it was not providing us the level of protection for our officers that we needed.
Sergeant Dana Costin says much of the equipment they've received through the program is outdated. Many of the weapons and vehicles dating back several decades are just no match for modern weaponry.
It's incapable of stopping modern rifle rounds. Then you really don't have a benefit there at all.
They are no longer good enough for the military. If they're obsolete, why are they on our streets? If they're no longer any good for them, why are they good for us?
That very question is up for debate, as well as the bigger picture. Is putting military-grade weapons in the hands of local police healthy for the relationship between those hired to protect and serve and the people they're serving? Dr. C says no.
That intimidation factor doesn't play well with the public.
But for those on the front line, that answer is much different.
If we have the ability to have this type of equipment, especially very cheaply, why would we not want to do that to protect our community and to protect our officers? That's my question.
While the 1033 program has received heavy criticism for dishing out weapons to local law enforcement agencies, emergency response supplies like generators, tents, water trailers, and other equipment critical during recovery efforts are also a large part of the now controversial program. For more on this story and for a full list of what gear your local police agency has received from the federal government, just head to our website, foxfornow.com. In the studio, Julian Glover, Fox 4 in your corner.
Canine's tied to a tree on a heavy chain. There's obvious signs of scarring on its face.
Thick, heavy chains. Confine these dogs to different trees, fences, even a trailer.
They separate the canines from each other because they're animal aggressive, so they can't be housed nearby.
These scarred faces.
I have one with fresh swelling on its face.
Are the faces of dog fighting.
Extremely fresh.
In the heart of Southwest Florida.
These dogs have no life. They have a life literally of being used just to tear each other to pieces.
Lieutenant Tony Backhurst shows me pictures of Lee County dogs, all torn to pieces, all for profit.
Those dogs will fight till one of them's dead. They can end in minutes, or they can go for hours.
This trailer was likely the scene of one fight, with dried blood on the carpet and chains set up along the walls. But the underground nature of these fights makes it nearly impossible to catch the criminals involved.
Because of the nature of them setting up so quick and getting out of there so quick, the likelihood of finding a fight actually going on as it happens is very, very unlikely. You're not going to see that.
Instead,
we got some information that these individuals are involved in dog fighting.
Officers work to track down the operation, even when a fight isn't happening. I rode along during one of those missions when officers discovered these dogs, almost all of them with scars.
Look at his legs, scars on his legs.
Or swelling.
Oh yeah, that's fresh swelling.
Are all these wounds pretty indicative of fighting?
Yes. Plus, we're seeing a litter of puppies, so that leads us to believe that they're fighting them. They're either fighting them or training them, and as well as breeding them.
These missions are considered dangerous, and since animal control officers are unarmed, they say it's crucial to have law enforcement on scene.
Guns are a big part of it. Gang members are usually a big part of this, so, it's absolutely essential.
In this house alone, officers removed 10 dogs, likely just a fraction of all the dogs currently being bred and raised for fighting in Southwest Florida.
How do we get on top of this here in Lee County in Southwest Florida?
Call us. Let us know when you see something that doesn't seem right. If you see a whole bunch of people in an area and you can hear dogs, and these things are not quiet.
Becker says be aware if you hear sounds of a dog in pain or if you hear loud cheering going on, just like a sporting event. Though he says there's nothing sport-like to any of this.
You're putting two animals into a position where they're fighting for their life. And you're doing it for your pleasure, your entertainment, and you're doing it to make money. And it's absolutely disgusting.
Palm trees glistening under the sun, toes planted in the sand, and the warm Gulf waters. From the spring breakers to the staycationers, it's safe to say that here in Florida, we love the beach. And like most things in life, when it comes down to picking a place to stay on the beach,
you know, it's location, location, plus locations.
Ruby Ruse thought she found the perfect location when she booked a room at the Pierview Hotel and Suites on Fort Myers Beach. But when she checked in,
quality indoor in the rooms is not the best.
Not the best is putting it lightly. Fox 4 did some digging and found the Florida Department of Business and Professional Regulation slapped the Pierview with more than a dozen health and safety violations all in the last 2 years alone, ranging from the unpleasant like paint peeling inside the top dresser drawer, inadequate ventilation, musty odor in bathroom, to the downright gross like a soiled bathroom sink with buildup of soap scum, mattress and box spring of bed soiled or stained, even as disgusting as a soiled refrigerator with a buildup of mold-like substances. We went inside of the Pierview Hotel and Suites, the hotel on Fort Myers Beach, with more violations than any other hotel. I asked the manager to comment on the issue. He told me he declined to comment and also that the hotel was under new management. So any issues that would have been present before aren't necessarily their problem. The Pierview isn't the only hotel on the beach getting a poor report card. In fiscal year 2012-13, there were 63 health and safety violations cited at the hotels and motels on F&B. And so far in this fiscal year, the tourist hotspots are looking to outdo themselves, with 62 violations already and several months of reporting left to go. The violations are widespread, from an objectionable odor being present at the property and toxic or poisonous material at the hotel not labeled, as cited at the Tahitian Inn Hotel off of San Carlos Boulevard. Other businesses like the Edgewater Inn were caught operating without a license or an expired license, and at the Edison Beach House, troubling violations, like a loose balcony railing on the second floor stairwell, along with expired balcony inspection certificates.
Any violation is unacceptable, but it's not necessarily alarming.
We took the question of exactly how alarmed you should be the next time you book a hotel on F&B to hospitality expert Keith Barron, professor at the University of South Florida Manatee.
It's very difficult to run a hotel, a restaurant, and not have some violations.
Are the hotels hiding something?
Inspectors don't make reservations. They don't call and say, we're going to be here at a certain time. They show up unannounced.
The Department of Business and Professional Regulation tells Fox 4 they inspect properties 2 to 3 times per year at random and perform additional inspections as needed whenever a vacationer like you makes a formal complaint.
Leaders, managers, they should be training housekeeping, they should be training their employees to regularly inspect.
Inspection is key, but several hotels and motels on the beach could do a better job at it. For example, one of the most notable names on the beach, which also happens to be one of the most notorious offenders, the Lonnie Kai.
You know, they don't care. They're not going to put a dime into it because the college kids are just going to drink beer, throw up, get up and do it all over again.
It's no secret the Lonnie Kai has quite the reputation with college students luring in spring breakers from around the world.
No regrets!
But known for mold growing in the air conditioning?
Air conditioning unit has accumulation of mold-like substance or observed gray-like substance and vents in one of the rooms.
If I knew about it, no, I wouldn't be happy staying there either.
The spring break mecca also plagued with a handful of other violations over the past 24 months, like dead flies found between the box spring and mattress, and even a high priority citation, like glassware, tableware, and utensils not cleaned and sanitized, and no notice to guests posted, a common violation on the beach.
When I hear that, it's the danger zone. the zone in which bacteria grows at a very rapid rate.
So we're making big steps to improve the bed rep that Lonnie Kai has.
Oh, big steps. I mean, if you take a look around at this, you won't even believe you're at the Lonnie Kai. It's pretty impressive.
Jamie Huffman is the marketing director of the 37-year-old F&B fixture. She tells me they've launched a multi-million dollar renovation project to give the Lonnie Kai a new reputation and a new look.
We're actually renovating all our rooms right now, so we just gutted all the bathrooms in every single hotel room.
Barron points out the Lonnie Kai taking the steps to turn around its image after being slapped with citations shows that the system of checks and balances is in place and working.
Of course they should be on the lookout for violations, for safety concerns, but I don't think that they have to necessarily fret about it.
Lesson learned for tourists on the beach.
I think it will make me look a little harder when I get to a motel room the next time.
1,000-watt lights, air conditioners, fertilizer, and guns for protection. Ingredients to get rich if it's done right. No one knows it better than this man.
I call it making money.
This former marijuana cultivator asked us to conceal his identity and voice.
The cops are following me around when they know I'm there.
He's sharing never-before-seen photos of his grow house in Southwest Florida. Pictures taken the day one of them was busted. Investigators seized 56 pounds of plants.
And they just showed up and armed with a shotgun and guns and rifles and took us out of the house and arrested me.
But despite mounting evidence, the case was dropped. A judge ruled deputies had illegally detained him without a search warrant. Rene Suarez is his attorney.
Many times they get a little overzealous and they arrest people before they have the probable cause to do so.
His client's story is one of many. Law enforcement reports a rise in marijuana grow houses across Southwest Florida. 2 years ago, 30 search warrants were served among Lee, Collier, Charlotte, and Hendry counties. Last year, 37, and a total of 22 have been served this year.
They're constantly changing their methods to try to stay one step ahead of us.
How do you keep up with them?
It's tough.
It's why we're not showing this Collier County narcotic deputy's face. Revealing it could put him in danger.
It's a cat and mouse game.
He says these operations are intricate. They steal thousands of kilowatts of electricity to power air conditioners. The room temperature must be just right.
You're not buying a little transformer in a box from Home Depot and then connecting it. It's a lot more extensive than that.
And power companies have no way of knowing.
With the drug house, the grow houses, it's not that easy for us to detect it with our reports because they're doing something to bypass the meter system.
This man says he figured it out. He trusted seven people to cultivate, protect, and keep his work secret.
And this business is people that would even grow it for you. You could hire them, put them inside a home, and they would do it for you.
For now, he says he's out of the drug trade.
If I could get into it in the future, I don't know.
But if there's a next time, he says, everything will be under the radar.
You don't tell people what you do. You could do something in your home and nobody would know about it, you know?
Christmas carols blaring, kids lined up to meet Santa, and stores rolling out their biggest sales of the year. Sure, the discounts are nice, but you're probably looking to save an extra buck, right? Well, what if I told you the tool to do it was in the palm of your hand the entire time? Jason White with Verizon Wireless explains.
And I found a different store that was less than 5 miles away, and if it wasn't for this application, I would have been spending $40 more on the exact same product.
So what's the secret? He used an app called Red Laser, just one of several smartphone apps available this holiday season, made with one goal in mind, saving you money.
Just how big will using smartphone apps to save money be this holiday season?
It's going to be absolutely huge. It makes their life easier. It brings products and services to them, pretty much anything you want.
Someone that knows a lot about bringing products and services to the palm of your hand is Sarah Berthold. She works for Edison Mall.
Deal or steal, coupons, everything. You know, there's a lot of deals out there, so it's good to check and see what's best.
Sarah's in charge of arranging the best in-store deals at Edison Mall and loading them onto the mall's smartphone app.
We want to make sure that the shoppers that come here, they're getting those good deals, they're getting those best deals, whether it's the regular price, a sale in the store, an additional coupon.
To get in on all the savings, just fire up the App Store on your iPhone or Google Marketplace on your Android device and download the Simon Malls app and select Edison Mall. No more coupon cutting, saving money has gone digital.
Here's JCPenney, let's click on it, extra 15% off.
And so you wouldn't have known about that if you didn't have the app.
Right.
Individual retailers like Target, Macy's, and Best Buy also offer additional apps jam-packed with coupons you can't find anywhere else.
There'll be everything from BOGOs to show this picture and get, you know, XYZ. So there's some great things that you can get by just having your phone with you.
If flashing coupons isn't your thing, there are several apps on the marketplace that allow you to compare deals by using your smartphone as your personal price scanner. Red Laser, Price Grabber, and Amazon Price Check are a few of the more popular apps. I demonstrated how to use Red Laser with a handful of holiday shoppers.
So this is the app right here. Just fire it up. You fire up the laser, and you'll hold it over the barcode.
And let's just say they were sold.
And you can check the barcode, like you said, go to another another place where it's cheaper. Why not do that?
If it's that quick, yeah, why not?
I am one to compare prices, for sure. I am trying to save every dime I can.
We're going shopping.
Deal or steal, in store or online. We've all got one thing in common. Everyone's just looking to save a buck.
Once they start saving money for the first time, for the second time, for the third time, they're going to become believers.
Black Friday is just around the corner, so be sure to check for all of the latest steals and deals as we get closer. But remember, when it comes to holiday shopping this year, you have a brand new weapon, and it's just a few taps away. Happy holiday shopping. Julian Glover, Fox 4, in your corner.
Blue zones are places on the earth where a large population surpasses 100 years old without crippling disease. These spots got their name simply because researchers circled them on a map using a blue marker. But to truly become a blue zone, you'll have to play a big role.
Collier County, a prime spot for fun in the sun, beautiful beaches, shopping, real estate, the true picture of paradise. Now on its way to be a global hotspot as one of the healthiest places in the world.
We're talking about our children's children living under a tree that we've planted today.
Dr. Alan Weiss with NCH is leading the charge locally in a 10-year plan to make Collier County a blue zone, adding to the short list of only a few places with a distinct title, like Icaria, Greece, Sardinia, Italy, and Okinawa.
Our oldest life expectancy for a woman in the United States right now is in Collier County. And that equals the average life expectancy of a woman in Japan. So our best is equaling the average in Japan.
Tony Buettner is helping to change that in Southwest Florida. He's one of the masterminds behind Blue Zones. His brother Dan wrote the book on the 9 ways to live a longer life by researching what other cultures are doing right, like connecting with community, eating better, and lowering stress. After applying the research to Albert Lea, Minnesota in 2009, Buettner says healthcare costs for city workers have gone down by 40%. He believes Collier County is the perfect place for longevity because of its location and leadership.
I've never seen a community so aligned for success.
This means the school district, grocery stores, and business leaders are all on board. But essentially changing our culture has its challenges.
You've got some horrible intersections.
That's where Blue Zone's Dan Burden, who focuses on rebuilding towns and cities, steps in.
You've got streets that misbehave totally, you know. You've got some of the worst drivers in America. People say Los Angeles got to have bad drivers. One of our team members from Los Angeles, she almost got wiped out last night. And so we're going to work with you on all those things.
Other things he's referring to, making the water more accessible to everyone, not just boaters. Creating more parks, community gardens, and safer bike paths. Florida is ranked one of the deadliest when it comes to cycling. Burden says if we can just get back to the basics, like walking to places, we'd all be better off.
If you can just eliminate 15,000 cars, that equates to an added $127 million that stays in the local economy and circulates and build more jobs.
Since living a long life is the goal, Blue Zone's researchers say connecting with the elderly is key.
As you know, I was around when the Great Depression took place.
Eleanor Moran is 101 and still serves on the foundation board at Gulf Coast Village in the Cape. living among several centenarians. None of them credit diet and exercise for their long lives.
Because I just lived.
The experts would say it's their sense of purpose that's helped, which is exactly what the Blue Zones project is designed to give you. In the meantime, it doesn't hurt to take some advice from someone who knows best.
Do the best you can with what you got.
By the looks of it, the best really is in Southwest Florida. Miriam Zamorano, Fox 4, in your corner.
Five letters. Just think about what am I doing right now.
It only takes one glance.
Smile?
Uh-huh. A simple look for your life to change in an instant.
You're operating a weapon. It's no different than someone putting a 45 caliber in your hand and you pointing it recklessly at someone.
That recklessness is something Jay Anderson, founder of Stay Alive, Just Drive, says he sees all too often on Southwest Florida roads.
I had a family member that was hit by a young man on the cell phone. You're either going to be good at driving or you're going to be good at texting. You're not good at either one of them at the same time.
As times and technology change, drivers are becoming more and more dependent on that tiny device we just can't seem to put down.
It's an addiction. I think there's no question any longer that this is an addictive behavior.
And Anderson says that addictive behavior is putting yours and everyone else's lives at risk.
That's the reality of it. When people get behind the wheel, they let their guard down. And every time we throw something else into the mix, that becomes a recipe for disaster.
It's a message Anderson and law enforcement try to drill into the minds of drivers, young and old. This simulator demonstrating just how easy it is to cause a crash with one single text. But are their warnings enough? Do drivers take the threat seriously? Last year, the state of Florida banned texting and driving, but the language of the law is looser than you might think.
Can it be frustrating that we may see someone texting and not doing any other sort of motor vehicle moving violation or have as another violation that they're committing, and we can't pull them over for it? Of course.
Right now, texting and driving is a secondary offense, meaning you have to be speeding or committing another violation before you can be ticketed. You can use a GPS on the road and text if you're stopped at a red light or stop sign.
All right, have a safe day.
We went for a ride along with the Florida Highway Patrol to see just how many drivers are breaking the rules. Trooper Carlos Gonzalez says he sees offenders all the time.
You'll see people looking down and you'll see a cell phone in their hand while they're driving. Sometimes you'll see them unable to maintain the lane that they're in.
But unfortunately, many times can't do anything about it. We were able to stop some speeders, but those texting got away.
I'm going to issue a warning this time, okay? Just make sure you keep the speed down, okay?
So it begs the obvious question, are our laws doing enough to keep Florida citizens safe on the roadways? Lieutenant Greg Bueno says it's up to lawmakers, but they're always on board for more protection.
The misconception people have is that sending a quick text is victimless. You know, who's it going to hurt? And they get away with it one time, two times, three times, a dozen times.
As of September of this year, 1,512 drivers have been ticketed for texting in the state. While Lieutenant Bueno says the law has raised awareness, it hasn't cut out crashes. So it's up to you, the driver, to ask yourself one question that could make a world of difference.
Is a text worth your life? Is a text worth someone else's life? It is not.